Learning medicine is hard work. Osmosis makes it easy. It takes your lectures and notes to create a personalized study plan with exclusive videos, practice questions, and flashcards, and so much more. Try it free today. With renal tubular acidosis, renal refers to the kidney. Tubular refers to the main tube portion of the nephron. And acidosis refers to having too many protons or increased acidity in the blood. So renal tubular acidosis, or RTA for short, describes increased acidity in the blood because the renal tubules can't get rid of protons. Now, the kidneys have millions of nephrons, each of which has a renal corpuscle, as well as a renal tubule that ends in a collecting duct. The renal corpuscle filters large amounts of solutes that go from the blood into the filtrate, and eventually the urine. And the renal tubule and collecting duct are responsible for fine-tuning the reabsorption and secretion of solutes to adjust the amount that ultimately gets retained by or removed from the body. Broadly speaking, renal tubular acidosis can develop in either the proximal convoluted tubule, sometimes just called the proximal tubule, or the distal convoluted tubule, or just distal tubule, as well as the nearby collecting duct. Now, the proximal tubule is lined by brush border cells which have two surfaces. One is the apical surface that faces the tubular lumen and is lined with microvilli. Microvilli are tiny little projections that increase the cell's surface area to help with solute reabsorption. The other is the basolateral surface, which faces the paratubular capillaries, which run alongside the nephron. Now, when a molecule of bicarbonate approaches the apical surface of the brush border cell, it binds to hydrogen to form carbonic acid. At that point, an enzyme called carbonic anhydrase type 4, which lurks in the tubule among the microvilli, just like a shark, swims along and splits the carbonic acid into water and carbon dioxide. The overall equation looks a little like this. Now, that water and carbon dioxide happily diffuses across the membrane into the cells, where carbonic anhydrase type 2 facilitates the reverse reaction, combining them to form carbonic acid, which dissolves into bicarbonate and hydrogen. A sodium bicarbonate co-transporter on the basolateral surface then snatches up the bicarbonate and a nearby sodium ion, and shuttles both into the blood. Meanwhile, a sodium-hydrogen exchanger on the apical surface pulls sodium into the cell, while pushing hydrogen back into the tubule. So at the end of the day, there's a movement of bicarbonate from the tubule to the blood. Okay, so now we're going to shift over to the distal tubule and collecting duct. First off, one type of cell these are lined with are the alpha intercalated cells. Like the brush border cells, the alpha intercalated cells move bicarbonate and hydrogen from the tubule into the cell using carbonic anhydrase. Now, the alpha intercalated cells have two major ways to get rid of that hydrogen that crosses the apical surface. First, they have a hydrogen ATPase, which simply pushes hydrogen into the tubule. Second, they have a hydrogen potassium ATPase, which pushes hydrogen into the tubule in exchange for potassium. With regard to bicarbonate, there's a bicarbonate chloride antiporter which moves bicarbonate into the blood in exchange for chloride. To prevent that chloride from piling up inside the cell, there's a potassium chloride symporter on the basolateral surface that moves both of these ions into the blood. In addition to this, there's also a chloride channel on the basolateral surface, which allows chloride to passively move down its concentration gradient and into the blood. Finally, it's worth mentioning that, just like all cells, sodium and potassium levels are controlled by the sodium-potassium ATPase pumps, which are on the basolateral surface and move two potassium ions into the cell and three sodium ions out of the cell. So overall, there's a net movement of sodium, chloride, and bicarbonate into the blood, while hydrogen is pushed into the tubule. Once in the lumen, hydrogen binds to phosphate or ammonia to form relatively weak acids like dihydrogen phosphate or ammonium, which then get peed out in the urine. This allows protons to get removed without making the urine too acidic and damaging the cells lining the tubules and the rest of the urinary tract. The other group of cells are the principal cells. These cells have two channels on the apical surface, a potassium channel that allows potassium into the lumen, and an epithelial sodium channel called ENAC that allows sodium into the cell. The flow of positively charged sodium ions into the cell helps drive the positively charged potassium ions out of the cell against their concentration gradient. Just like the other one, there's also a sodium-potassium ATPase pump on the basal lateral surface that again moves two potassium ions in for every three sodium ions out. All three of these are stimulated by aldosterone, and the combined effect is reabsorption of sodium and loss of potassium. In renal tubular acidosis type 1, or distal renal tubular acidosis, the main issue is that the alpha intercalated cells of the distal tubule and collecting duct are unable to secrete hydrogen. The buildup of hydrogen in those cells leads to a buildup of hydrogen in the blood, resulting in acidemia. The underlying cause could be a genetic mutation in the hydrogen ATPase pump or the hydrogen potassium ATPase pumps of the alpha intercalated cells. Alternatively, it could be due to an acquired defect from a medication like lithium or amphotericin B, both of which make cells permeable, allowing hydrogen to simply diffuse from the tubule right back into the cell. A less common mechanism is a defect in the bicarbonate chloride antiporter, which causes a decrease in bicarbonate reabsorption, and less bicarbonate in the blood also leads to acidemia. In renal tubular acidosis type 2, or proximal renal tubular acidosis, the main issue is that the brush border cells of the proximal tubule are unable to reabsorb bicarbonate. As a result, bicarbonate gets lost in the urine, and this means that there's nothing to counterbalance those hydrogen ions, resulting in acidemia. One known cause is a genetic mutation in the sodium bicarbonate cotransporter on the basolateral surface that makes it less functional. Being less able to move bicarbonate out of the cell alters the intracellular bicarbonate concentration and makes it more difficult for bicarbonate to get brought across the apical surface into the cell. As a result, less bicarbonate gets reabsorbed by the brush border cells, and more is left behind in the lumen of the tubule. Eventually, losing bicarbonate in the urine means that there's less bicarbonate in the blood, resulting in acidemia. Unlike in renal tubular acidosis type 1, the distal intercalated cells are still functional, and therefore can produce hydrogen ions, and can generally still acidify the urine. Renal tubular acidosis type 2 can happen independently or can be part of a broader dysfunction of the proximal tubular cells called Fanconi syndrome. In Fanconi syndrome, in addition to loss of bicarbonate, there's also phosphaturia, glycosuria, aminoaciduria, uricosuria, and proteinuria. The loss of phosphate, glucose, amino acids, uric acid, and protein in the urine. Fanconi syndrome can be inherited, but can also be acquired. For example, it can be a side effect of certain medications like tetracycline class antibiotics. In renal tubular acidosis type 3, there's a defect in both the distal and proximal tubule, which is a fairly uncommon situation. The causes of this aren't very well known, but some cases have been associated with congenital carbonic anhydrase deficiency, and this is because carbonic anhydrases are present in both the distal and the proximal tubule. Finally, there's renal tubular acidosis type 4, sometimes called hyperkalemic acidosis, and it's classically due to aldosterone deficiency or aldosterone resistance in the collecting duct, affecting both the principal and alpha intercalated cells. Aldosterone has an important role in the regulation of sodium, potassium, and hydrogen levels. An example of aldosterone deficiency is Addison's disease, where the adrenal gland doesn't produce enough of it. An example of aldosterone resistance is a mutation in the epithelial sodium channel, so that it doesn't respond well to normal levels of aldosterone. Either way, a reduced effect of aldosterone can decrease the function of the sodium-potassium ATPase, making sodium levels fall and potassium levels rise in the blood. Also, a reduced effect of aldosterone on the hydrogen ATPase in the intercalated cells means that more hydrogen gets retained in the cells and eventually in the blood, causing the acidemia. Overall, this causes high potassium, or hyperkalemia, and high levels of hydrogen ions, or acidemia. Also, since hydrogen usually combines with ammonia in the tubule to form ammonium, with less hydrogen, there'll be less ammonium formed and excreted in the urine. Now, there are some other causes of renal tubular acidosis type 4 as well. One of them is severe hypovolemia, or low fluid volume, which means less sodium is available for reabsorption in the principal cells. The result of this is lower sodium levels inside the cell, which alters the ion exchange between sodium and potassium, resulting in low sodium and high potassium levels in the blood, and the resulting hyperkalemia contributes to acidosis. Another cause of renal tubular acidosis type 4 is systemic lupus erythematosus, as well as medications like lithium or amphotericin B, both of which make the distal tubule and collecting duct cells more permeable to hydrogen ions, allowing them to diffuse into the blood and causing acidosis. Initially, symptoms of renal tubular acidosis include gastrointestinal problems like decreased appetite, vomiting, and abdominal pain. But if it's left untreated, severe metabolic acidosis can lead to vasodilation of peripheral arterioles, which can cause shock. Like other causes of metabolic acidosis, there's a compensatory pattern of breathing called Cosmol breathing, where a person initially takes rapid, shallow breaths that get deeper over time, in order to blow off the carbon dioxide. Also, the urine tends to be more alkaline than normal, typically greater than a pH of 6. This especially happens in renal tubular acidosis type 1 and can sometimes happen in the acute setting for renal tubular acidosis type 2. This causes hyperkalciuria and leads to the precipitation of calcium phosphate, which can cause painful kidney stones. Renal tubular acidosis is a metabolic acidosis, meaning it has a pH below 7.35 and a low bicarbonate level, with a normal anion gap. That means that the difference between the measured cations, sodium and potassium, and the measured anions, chloride and bicarbonate, is between 8 milliequivalents per liter and 12 milliequivalents per liter. In addition, blood potassium and urine pH are typically done to identify the exact type of renal tubular acidosis. Low levels of bicarbonate in the blood also leads to elevated levels of chloride, so hyperchloremia is a classic finding in renal tubular acidosis. Now, for treatment in renal tubular acidosis type 1 and 2, the main goal is to replenish bicarbonate and correct hypokalemia with potassium citrate. In just renal tubular acidosis type 2, this can be achieved with thiazide diuretics, which cause water loss and increased reabsorption of bicarbonate. As for renal tubular acidosis type 4, the goal is to treat hypoaldosteronism with fludrocortisone or loop diuretics, which increases sodium delivery to the collecting duct and increases potassium hydrogen exchange. Alright, as a quick recap, renal tubular acidosis describes a condition in which the kidney is unable to secrete acids or reabsorb bicarbonate from the body. This most commonly results in metabolic acidosis with a normal anion gap. If left untreated, the acidemia can cause peripheral vasodilation and shock. Thanks for watching. If you're interested in a deeper dive on this topic, take a look at osmosis.org, where we have flashcards, questions, and other awesome tools to help you learn medicine. Otherwise, you can always support us by donating on Patreon, subscribing to our channel, or following us on social media.